Morning Church family. I want to welcome you all this morning. My name is Jason Bush. I'm filling in for Pastor Terry as he's gone yet this week on vacation. If you would all take just a few moments to look at the announcements on the back of your bulletin, a couple I want to point out would be, one is the Charge Conference is coming up where our church cluster of churches gather on, that will be October 20th over at the Jefferson Methodist Church from 6 to 8. If you're wanting to join us, let Sherry know and we can carpool over there. And the only other one I want to point out right now would be the pork chop chicken dinner that is coming up, and that would be coming up on October 23rd from 4 to 7. That will be an in-person pork chop dinner this year, to where we'll have it in Fellowship Hall, but we will also have carryouts and deliveries available like we always have in the past. And that will be, like I said, from 4 to 7, and the meals are going to be $12 per meal. With that, I would ask for our candlelighters to come forward for our prelude.
We gather here with many different spiritual gifts.
We gather here with one Holy Spirit.
We gather here with many different parts of the church body.
We gather here with Christ as the head of the body.
We are all baptized by the same Spirit.
We are all fed by the same Spirit.
Come, Holy Spirit,
feed us, guide us, and protect us.
Now we're going to have just a moment in mission. I know it was, it's been quite a while ago. Back in July, we had 8 of us go on a mission trip out to Loving, Colorado with group mission. And I want to invite Matt Clucky, Haley Clucky, Amelia Clucky, Jillian Chumley, and Haley Bush forward. They're going to share about their experiences just a little bit. And while they're coming up, I just want to talk to you about what the theme was for the week. They'll share about their experiences and what they were doing for the week, but throughout the week, we would also get together, and the theme for the entire week overall was to go serve, and each day, there was like a theme behind that. On Monday, the theme behind that was to go serve with freedom, where Paul taught Jesus, and you're identified identity as him. Tuesday, to go serve with purpose. Wednesday was to go serve with humility. Thursday was to go serve with gratitude. And then Friday morning, as we went home, it was to go serve with God. So with that, I will let you guys kind of just take a moment, talk about what you did throughout the week to serve the communities of Loveland and Greeley and the surrounding communities, and then what your biggest takeaway was. Somebody's got to go first.
Okay. I'm Matt Klucky, and I went. This was my first mission trip. I went thinking that I was going to be doing a bunch of backbreaking work, and I ended up doing respite care. Never done it before. I got five kids. They push my buttons, so working respite with younger people took a lot of patience. I had a, sorry, this guy, every time I think of him, it's amazing because he couldn't speak. He was stimulated by a lot of stuff. So we found a lot of ways as we worked with him every week to figure out what he was communicating with us. When we'd eat lunch, we would feed him and that. He would tell us just by putting his hand out like that, he was done. He didn't want that. We try something else. 19 years old, kid, probably a little bit taller than me, skinnier than me, and this kid knew exactly what he wanted to do. He would push through you if he wanted to go, and I'm no small man, and he pushed me around. So it was very challenging. We did go to a bowling alley. There was a lot of lights from the arcade. He got super stimulated. We probably spent 45 minutes to an hour trying to get him out. And we have everybody looking at us in that bowling alley. It was one of the most mentally straining moments of my life. Because I didn't know what to do. I didn't know what was right, what was wrong, but just to see how he reacted was just, it was sad, but throughout the week, just to see his smile when we did things, because you would see just stuff. I had to play a lot of SpongeBob Radio. He loves SpongeBob Radio. So, he would sit there with a soccer ball and he basically would just do this. I'd play the music, and when he found a song that he really liked, he really let us know. And that was, like I said, it's truly amazing. So I didn't expect it. It was a great trip. I'm so glad that I went. So thank you guys for letting me go.
Thank you for going, Matt. All right, ladies, who's gonna be the first one out of you three? Jillian. Jillian, just tell us where you served and what your most memorable moment was.
So we all got split into different groups, and I was in a group with two other girls, well, three other girls, and we pulled weeds for most of the week, and then we got to help in the food bank. And
what do you remember most about the week?
Getting to serve the community and help them out.
Awesome. Thanks, Jillian.
So I was with a group of disabled adults. It was kind of like a daycare. Their parents would like drop them off during the day. There was a couple of people that were really excited to see us. They would like call the coordinator every day. Are the volunteers here? Are they here? So they were really excited for us to be there. It was really heartwarming when you walked in and they all had smiles on their face and were so excited to see you. There was a lot of people that couldn't speak, so we ended up learning a little bit of sign language to communicate with them as well. And overall, I just had a great week. We played Just Dance with them too, and they really enjoyed that.
I worked in like a homeless shelter slash like grocery store, clothes pantry, and we help people like get their groceries and for like the week, and it wasn't their main supply of groceries, that it would just last them for like the whole week. And the most like memorable thing that what I remember is seeing like the smiles on the people's faces when like you would go back each day and they would tell you like thank you for what you're doing and getting to make like new connections with other people in Colorado.
Thank you. And I know we've got Allison and Camden King that will hopefully, when their schedule allows, we're going to have them here. And since Amelia wasn't able to be here this morning either, we'll hopefully work those three in so that they can share about their experiences as well. But yeah, there were 8 church youth groups there all together from many different states. We had one church youth group from Hawaii even that had flown in. That was kind of neat to have them there. But it's all different denominations and such that use group mission trips. And with that, I just want to hand out these community service awards to everyone. It says that they served 30 hours of community service on a group mission trip. Haley? Mia's not here. Jillian? And Haley Bush? And if you guys. Now, it's the time for our joys and concerns, and I know I've got a few here already, and then we'll ask for others from our church family. The first one is a praise. Sherry Hoagland, our secretary, Sherry and Greg, have a new grandson, Charles Daniel, born to Zach and Ellie out on the East Coast. So we want to praise God for that and ask for blessings for their growing family. Next would be prayer for Linda Blummel and Reg Conrad's niece Bailey, passed away this past week. So I want to ask that all of our church family would lift them all up in this time of loss. Not sure what happened there, but just lift the family up. Marilyn Markey, I know we were praying for her last week. She did pass away, so I'd ask that we keep Marilyn's family in our thoughts and prayers, too, for their loss. Then heard that Carol Kirby fell and broke her shoulder, so we want to keep Carol Kirby in our thoughts and prayers as well. Rose, I think Rose is here. Rose's nephew, Tim, we want to keep Tim in our thoughts and prayers too. She was talking to me a little bit about Tim this morning. He's going through a second round of cancer, prostate cancer, so we want to lift him up. She was saying that he had lost his son here earlier, or his daughter, and they had adopted her kids. That had just went through to where he was going to be able to adopt them, and he found out that he has cancer again. So we want to keep Tim and his family in our thoughts and prayers. And then Les, I see Les is here. Les, I know that you've kind of switched your chemotherapy drugs, so we want to keep you in our thoughts and prayers too, that all of that goes well. And I know I see Angie back there. Angie, we want to continue to pray for your mom as well. So are there others that we can be praying for this week, though? Yes, Les.
My niece Cindy passed away. That'd be my oldest brother's middle daughter. She had quite a bout with very bad chemo on colon cancer, and then got through that, and then she just, let's see, about Tuesday, she put her on hospice, and she passed away on Thursday, gone into her bones and that stuff.
Cindy, you said, right?
Yeah, Cindy, 262.
Pray for Cindy as well. Are there others we can lift up? Or Joyce? Yes, Barb.
That's fine. Karen Bolo.
So the diabetes program coming up, that it can help outreach. Yeah. Awesome. Thanks, Barb.
Jason?
Oh. Yes.
Noah Heston's birthday is tomorrow. He turns 16. So if you see him out and about, you can wish him happy birthday.
Noah's 16. All right. If you're watching, Noah, happy birthday. Awesome. Yes, it's very great to have a full bell choir. And another joy is that it was Carol's homecoming this week and they had great weather. CJ.
A joy is we attended the orchestra concert last night. It was marvelous. And Jake had a leading role. He always has a supporting role when he directed a number. And I see some of the other orchestra members here. And so it was wonderful. And we're so lucky to have that wonderful group. And it's again this afternoon at 1 o'clock. So, be sure to go. It's at the Rec Center.
Awesome. Are there others? Yeah. Oh.
Claire Stolt got her appendix removed, and she's at her home right now, but I just want to hear that she gets up with
me. Claire Stolt. Okay. Thank you, ma'am. Yeah, Matt.
I got a message from my mom that her and my call friend, Sherry Stolt, passed away. So I'd like to keep her family in our contact.
Sherry Stolt. Okay. This is awesome. Who else can we lift up in praise this morning? All right. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, I want to thank you for this morning. Thank you for using me. Lord, we come with many joys and concerns this morning. We pray that we give you great blessings for Charles Daniels, grandson of Greg and Sherry Hoagland. We give you great thanks for all of our wonderful bell choir here this morning, filled in with our high schoolers, and we give you great praise for the awesome homecoming for Carroll High. Lord, we do want to lift up Linda and Reg and their family in the passing of Bailey. We want to lift up Marilyn Markey's family, Lord, in her passing. We want to pray for Carol Kirby that you would help heal her. Lord, we lift up Rose's nephew, Tim, in his battle with cancer. We lift up Les in his battle with cancer, Lord. We lift up Cindy. We lift up and give you great praises for the diabetes program. And we pray for all those that are affected by diabetes. We want to pray for Sherry Spohr and her family, Lord. We pray for Claire Stolk. And we just pray for all of us here as well, Lord, for all of our hurts and needs, that we lean on you, as we know that when we lean on you, we can get through anything, because it is your Son that taught us all to pray the prayer, Our Father, who art in heaven,
hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Thank you.
put a heavy yoke on us, but now lighten the harsh labor and the heavy yoke he put on us, and we will serve you. Rehoboam answered, go away for 3 days and then come back to me. So the people went away. Then King Rehoboam consulted the elders who had served his father Solomon during his lifetime. How would you advise me to answer these people? He asked. They replied, if today you will be a servant to these people and serve them and give them a favorable answer, they will always be your servants. But Rehoboam rejected the advice the elders gave him and consulted the young men who had grown up with him and were serving him. He asked them, what is your advice? How should we answer these people who say to me, lighten the yoke your father put on us? The young men who had grown up with him replied, these people have said to you, your father put a heavy yoke on us, but make your yoke lighter. Now you tell them, my little finger is thicker than my father's waist. My father laid on you a heavy yoke. I will make it even heavier. My father scourged you with whips. I will scourge you with scorpions. 3 days later, Jeroboam and the people all returned to Rehoboam, as the king had said. Come back to me in 3 days, he said. The king answered the people harshly, rejecting the advice given by the elders, and he followed the advice of the young men and said, my father made your yoke heavy. I will make it even heavier. My father scourged you with whips. I will scourge you with scorpions. So the king did not listen to the people, for this turn of events was from the Lord to fulfill the word the Lord had spoken to Jeroboam, son of Nebat, through Ahijah the Shilonite. Praise to the Lord Jesus Christ.
In a time full of war, be peace. In a time full of doubt, just believe. Yeah, there ain't that much difference between you and me. In a time full of war, be peace. In a world full of hate, be a light. When you do somebody wrong, that needs change and make a difference. In a time full of noise, just listen. Cause life is but a breeze, better live it. In a place that needs to change.
So our sermon this week is Better Together. Could have been Be a Light as well, because that's what we're told to do. Last week, Clay shared with us in the story about King Solomon an incredibly wise king. But Solomon was also very much so human, like all of us here this morning. He had his own hurdles in life. At the end of the 13th chapter that Clay spoke about last week, we find one of those hurdles that Solomon stumbles with. God had warned Solomon that he nor any of the Israelites should intermarry with women from other nations like the Moabites, Ammonites, and Hittites. The Lord warned all of Israel that the relationships with these people from these nations would turn their hearts towards the gods of these nations, worshiping them, leading them away from the one God that we all worship. Unfortunately, Solomon didn't listen to the Lord on this matter. And in fact, he had 300 concubines or mistresses from these nations to go along with the 700 wives he had from royal birth. These concubines that he had relationships drew Solomon's heart away from the Lord, and the Lord became angry with Solomon for this. Solomon had not followed God's command, and this allowed his heart to be turned away from God. God then told Solomon, since he had not listened and followed God's command, that he was going to tear the kingdom of Israel away from Solomon and his family and give it to someone else. That's where we find ourselves in chapter 14 of the story this morning. And God once again is following through with the promise that he had made Solomon. As Barb read, Solomon's son, Rehoboam, had been accepted as the new king after the passing away of Solomon. And we hear how at the end of the reign of Solomon, he had been very harsh to the people of Israel as he had taxed them heavily and demanded very much of them. Like Barb continued to read this morning, Rehoboam was met by one of the upset Israelites in Jeroboam. Jeroboam pleaded with King Rehoboam to lessen the load that his father had placed on the people. And at first, Rehoboam started to do something quite wise himself when he consulted with the elders from the kingdom and asked, "What do you guys think?" And they told Rehoboam, "Yes, the people are right. Your father had gotten off God's path towards the end of his reign, and he had been too hard on God's people of Israel." I guess King Rehoboam didn't like that answer. A lot of times we ask people for advice, and if we don't like it, we go to someone else until we get the right advice that we think is right. And he went to the younger men in the kingdom that Rehoboam had grown up with, and he asked them, "What do you guys think?" And as Barb read to us, they told him to be an even tougher king than his father Solomon was to the people of Israel. And that's when it happened. Just as God had promised Solomon, Jeroboam and the people of the northern tribes split off from Judah, and the people of Judah were left with Rehoboam, and the northern tribes of Israel had King Jeroboam. Now, the two different divided nations were at war with each other for quite some time, and both went through many kings after Jeroboam and Rehoboam, most of which didn't listen to God, didn't follow him, and did evil rather than good to the people of their nations. Now we see, I know, Terry, as we've been going through the story, we talk about the lower stories and the upper stories. As we see here in chapter 14, the lower story is that quite often people want to follow their own paths. And way too often, though, when we try to do that, we get lost and led on a path to destruction, led on a path away from God by Satan and his followers. Because remember, everyone, Satan's one task is to separate us from God. Do everything that he possibly can to make us think that God doesn't love us. And that's a lie. But God, on the other hand, has promised each and every one of us that he wants all of his children to follow him, to enter into his kingdom of heaven that he has prepared for everyone. Rehoboam didn't listen to God. He didn't care for God's people the way that God had told him to. So they left, and they said they could do better. And Jeroboam, though he didn't do much better at taking care of the people of Israel, because he didn't do a very good job of listening to God either. He didn't care for God's children very well. So what is God trying to show us here? What is the upper story of this story that we're focusing on this week? God is trying to show us that he keeps his promises. If we think back, when David became king, God had promised David that he would make Israel a great nation. And above that promise, he told David that his tribe, the tribe of Judah, would be established forever. With God making this promise, he's keeping it by allowing Rehoboam to remain king of Judah. But it's so upsetting to God that both of these communities couldn't live together and follow God's word. But unfortunately, that's the same way we see our world today in, where we don't put God first. In the story, it spoke of a yoke, Solomon's yoke being very heavy on all of Israel. Rehoboam spoke of making a yoke even harder than his father's. But I think about a yoke that is talked about in the Gospel of Matthew in chapter 11, verses 29 and 30, when we hear Jesus Christ himself say, "Come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls, for my yoke is easy and my burden is light." Think about this statement in our lives today, how hard it can be. And then think about which is easier, to have a good relationship with the people in your lives or to be at war with others. It takes so much effort to get upset and be mad at others, and it doesn't take hardly any to just love others around us. And that's easy to say, a hard thing to follow, though, isn't it? But when we look back in the verse that Jesus said, he told us how to do it. He said, "Take my yoke upon you and learn from me." That's what it's going to take. And that's why it's so important for all of us to, like I tell the youth, it's so important for all of us to be reading our Bibles. That Bible that's in your pews right there, it's a map of our lives and how we should be living it. And it's going to show us that his path is easier. Another interesting point in the story this morning is, why would God separate the nations when he wants us all together in his kingdom? Because that's his ultimate goal for everyone. And that's where free will comes into it. And each of us has to decide what path we want to take through our lives. God is definitely not someone that's going to be a puppet master and drag everyone into the kingdom of heaven he has prepared for us. That's on us to decide which path we're going to follow. But rather, he's going to allow us to follow our own paths, make our own choices. And when we make bad choices, praise God for grace, because he's there to get us right back on that right path, just like the Israelites and the people of Judah. But the road to eternal life is offered to everyone, no matter what nation you come from. But the road to destruction is also out there. And like it says in the New Testament, that road is broad and the gate is wide. And there's lots of glitzy things on that road to make us think that that's the right road to be on. And Satan wants us on that path. But God wants us on that narrow road that will lead to that eternal heaven that he has prepared for each and every one of us. But in order to stay on that road, we're going to have to ask him for help in guiding us and keeping us on that path. The song that and video we watched right before I started speaking this morning was written by country music singer Thomas Rhett, and he wrote it during the COVID pandemic. He wanted to encourage everyone in the world that they could be a light in what is often viewed as a dark world that we do live in. And he hopes that people can be encouragement to others. When I used this video a couple years ago through the pandemic for a youth lesson when we had to meet online and couldn't get together. But when I think of that song, I think of another song, This Little Light of Mine, that I'm sure all of you here this morning are familiar with. And just think about that song for a moment. And when we stick with God in all that we do, we can be his light, and we're not going to hide it under a bushel. We're going to let it shine brighter, and we'll draw others towards him, like is our business to do while we're on this earth. The Gospel of Matthew chapter 5, 14 through 16 reminds us that being the light of the world and to let our light shine before others. As we close this morning, just want to remind us all that we really are a better people when we're together. When we're together with God, first and foremost, listening to him, allowing him to make our lights shine brighter, learning from him. So as we close this morning, I would just ask that each of you go into the world this week, making sure that God is with you and that you lean on his yoke. Because when you do that, it's going to be a lot easier and your light is going to shine a lot brighter for all. As we go, remember the church isn't a building, rather people who follow Jesus. And those that follow Jesus are unstoppable force in this world. Therefore, I challenge each of you this upcoming week to go out into the world, be a light of God's love wherever there might be darkness. Amen.